Welcome to Talking with Tatchell. In Iran over the last year, we've witnessed rising resistance to the regime of President Ahmadinejad. There have been a succession of workers' protests, first the bus workers, now more recently the teachers. There have been mass protests by women and students, and a rising discontent amongst Iran's national minorities, the persecuted Ahwazi Arabs in the south and the Baluchis and others. With me to discuss the prospects for regime change from within, that is, by and for the Iranian people, is Maryam Namazi, broadcaster, feminist and communist, herself from Iran, and now fighting to ensure a democratic and socialist Iran in the future. Welcome, Maryam.
Thanks very much. Glad to be here.
I'd like to start by asking you to just give us a little resume about the recent suppression of the International Women's Day protests in Iran.
Well, you yourself reported on it recently in The Guardian. I read an article you'd written. I think it's basically what happened was there were a number of women who went to demonstrate in front of the court in defense of other women who had been arrested for opposing the discriminatory laws in Iran. And they themselves were then arrested, over 30 people. Most of them have been released by now. There's still two people in prison. They were treated horribly, beaten, under really terrible conditions. And again, what I want to make clear is that this was not a rare incident. It's something that happens very regularly in Iran. As you mentioned yourself in the piece you wrote on the Guardian website, is that it's the bad thing is it's not very often reported.
Mm. I mean, that suppression of this year's International Women's Day protest was the third big attack on women's rights protests in Iran in the last year. There was the one last June and, of course, the previous International Women's Day in 2006. Mm. I mean, do we get a sense that in Iran more and more women are unprepared to submit to the orthodoxies of the theocratic regime, that there is this growing sense that women don't want to be under the veil, don't want to be second-class citizens, they want full rights? Or is this just a small fragment of the women's population, perhaps the better educated the more intellectual wing?
Well, I mean, I think that this is something that's been going on for a very long time, and not just the past few years. And I think it's very clearly representative of what is actually taking place in Iran. It's a huge movement against the Islamic Republic of Iran and against religion in power, against theocracy. It's very much female-led and young-led, because 70% of the population in Iran is under the age of 30. The majority of them have been born under an Islamic government, but they've been opposing it very vehemently and loudly. And I think these protests that we hear about actually are the tip of the iceberg of what's happening day in and day out by people in Iran against the regime. And oftentimes it's organized, but many times they're, you know, individual acts of resistance as well. And I think that we don't hear about those enough, where people try to save a woman who's being arrested by the religious police or the morality police because she has been properly veiled, or people throwing off their veils in the middle of the street, dancing when it's banned to Western music, for example. A lot of things that people do day in and day out and take for granted because they're banned in Iran, they also become acts of resistance, from how people chose to wear their veil, for example, to transgressing those rules and regulations, to mixing and segregating with the male sex, for example. All these are examples of how people daily resist the Islamic regime, to more organized protests that you've mentioned.
But do you think that these individual defiances, as well as the collective ones, do you think they're really deep-seated at the grassroots, you know, in ordinary communities, or is it more the better educated, that section of the population? I'm trying to get a sense of how great and deep the rebellion is by women against the patriarchy that exists in Iran today.
I think it's actually very widespread. I know that oftentimes you do hear in the media that this is just, you know, a middle class, upper class or middle class women, for example, resisting, or youth and so on and so forth. But actually, if you look at the many forms of resistance, worker-related resistance and protests, women-led protests, the youth, you see that it goes across a very wide different classes, different backgrounds, and it's very widespread. And it happens, if you actually follow protests that are taking place in Iran, there are protests, you know, every hour, basically, in this factory, in that neighborhood, in this on this commemorative day. If you just look at the past few weeks, the past week in Iran, for example, you see protests, for example, at universities, women and men doing sit-ins because the university is demanding stricter dress codes on women, and they're refusing to comply. And I think oftentimes you actually see how widespread it is by the reaction of people in government. Mm-hmm. You know, when they're constantly whining about the fact that it's not Islamic enough, the society, and they're constantly trying to impose stricter regulations, even though regulations are already so strict and impossible for the 21st century for people to be able to, you know, manage them. But even so, they want it to be stricter and stricter all along. And you can see that that's actually a reaction to the protests that are all very widespread.
I mean, just a couple of weeks ago, we saw 100,000 teachers on strike. Mm-hmm. Do you want to tell us a little bit about the heroic strike by the bus workers last year? I think is something like 1,300 striking bus workers were arrested, many of them put in Evin prison and tortured. Mm-hmm. Many of the leaders were held for months and months, also grotesquely tortured by the regime. Do you want to just tell us a little bit about that?
And including, for example, wives and children of leaders of bus workers were arrested. And I think, again, I think the important thing is that was one of the protests that came to light, that got known about. The teachers, for example, right now, 300 have been arrested just a few days ago. Many of the leaders of the teacher strike are languishing in prison right now, being tortured. And being threatened, and I think the main point is that this is very something quite the norm in Iran for these protests to take place. And sometimes people will say, well, we have labor protests in the West as well. And I think what's important to recognize is the fact that these protests quickly become very political, even if they are for basic demands for, you know, better wages or better working conditions. They become very political. They become very much vis-a-vis the Islamic Republic of Iran in its entirety. And that's why they're very influential and important in the struggle to change the situation in Iran. And we can't look at them as just a women's rights protest, for example, or just a labor protest like the bus workers one. They actually have a huge impact in society. A vast numbers of society in general support the struggle and become involved in these strikes and come out in the street in support of, for example, the bus workers or the teachers. And so they're actually quite instrumental in bringing about change in Iran.
And in terms of the bus workers' strike, for example, I get the impression that the international solidarity movement, support from trade unionists and some left-wing groups in the West, was actually quite important. First of all, in giving the imprisoned trade unionists, you know, a psychological morale boost, but also helping to pressure the regime to eventually release most of them.
Yeah, I mean, I think in many situations across the world, we've seen how international protest is important and has an impact. And I think in Iran, we have hundreds and hundreds of examples in this past year, let alone in the decades that the regime has ruled that country. But if you look at even the bus workers, you have the case of Nazanin Fatehi, a teenager who was to be executed. She herself said that if it hadn't been...
Explain why she was going to be executed.
She was going to be executed for a murder. She was about to be raped along with her niece. And she had a knife with her, and she killed one of the people who was trying to attack her. And she was actually given a death sentence for it. And she was to be executed. And it is because of all the international pressure, as well as internal pressure in Iran, in defense of her case, she is now a free woman.
And how is she going to be executed?
And by hanging. Mm-hmm. But of course, there are other forms as well, like stoning and other forms of executions that still take place in Iran. But I think international pressure is very instrumental. And I know there are groups sometimes that say, oh, you shouldn't put pressure on the Islamic Republic. It's going to have a backlash. And it'll just say that they're Western lackeys or spies, and it won't help. And I think that's not the case. I think international solidarity of people with people is essential. And it worked in South Africa against the racial apartheid regime then, and it has to work for the Islamic Republic of Iran, which represents sexual apartheid in this century. So I think it has been instrumental, and it needs to continue and become a lot stronger actually than it has been.
You just described the Iranian Islamic regime as enforcing a policy of sexual apartheid. Can you just explain briefly what this means? You know, what it actually means to be a woman in Iran, the denial of basic human rights?
I mean, I think one of the things that's important is that oftentimes in the media you hear about how, with the whole theory of cultural relativism, that it's their culture, it's their religion, and this is how people choose to live. And I think one of the important things is that for people to realize is that actually people are forced to live in this way. And for the Islamic Republic of Iran to maintain itself, 100,000 people have been executed in the past 2 decades. And one of its pillars has been the suppression of women and the imposition of sexual apartheid. And practically what this means is, like racial apartheid in South Africa, there's a curtain in the Caspian Sea separating men and women from swimming. There are different mountains for women to ski on and men to ski on. Women have to sit in different places in buses. They have different entrances sometimes for government offices. And the most visible symbol of that is actually the veil, where women have to be covered and, for example, can't shake the hands of a man who's not closely related to them, and so on and so forth. So it has, you know, the practical implications are vast, and I think it surprises me that we still haven't reached a point where the world is completely outraged at the situation in Iran and other countries that are ruled by Islam, and that I think we need to reach a point where sexual apartheid is as despised as racial apartheid is, and as something that's no longer acceptable and tolerated. And I think it's tolerated too much and too often, and the realities of it are important to really understand what it means for women and girls, very much so.
You draw the analogy with race apartheid. Of course, that raises the whole issue of the deep-seated Persian chauvinism and racism that goes across Iranian society, with the very severe persecution of many of the minority nationalities, like the Azeris, the Turkmen, the Kurds, the Baluchis, and particularly the Wazi Arabs. I was really shocked that, you know, recently 7 Arab rights activists in southwest Iran were executed, and there was hardly a murmur of international outrage or outcry. And, you know, these are just the latest of a whole series of executions, and this is the oil-rich region of Iran, which is the most one of the most impoverished in the country, and the standards of living for the people there are equivalent to, you know, parts of Africa. It's unbelievable in this day and age that the world can not recognize the racism of the Iranian regime. And I just wonder what you feel about the whole issue of, you know, the struggle of national minorities in Iran to get a fair and just treatment. I don't think, you know, there are some separatist elements, but most of the people there want to be part of the Iranian state, but they want self-government. They want an end to persecution and victimization. What's your take on this?
I mean, I think the persecution of anyone is intolerable and shouldn't be tolerated. And as you said, it's something that, Amina Ahadi mentioned in this seminar that we had in International Women's Day, is that one stoning or one execution should actually be enough to make, you know, people who defend humanity turn the world upside down, you know, in protest and outrage. And, you know, Iran is one of the execution capitals of the world, not just of ethnic minorities, of women, of political opponents, and across the board, of gays, you know, you name it. And there are, you know, I don't know, it's after China, it's got the highest number of executions in the world. It's got the highest number of juveniles on death row in the world. And so it's an issue that's, that affects all segments of the population, and it's a racist, misogynist, homophobic regime. And I think that it's important to always to be able to highlight cases like this, gather support and solidarity for cases like this. But also, I think I think that for me personally, I feel like we need to be careful not to put a label. Let me say it this way. I think that one of the problems in Iraq, for example, if we look at what's happening there, is the fact that the country has been divided into a million religions and ethnicities. And I think that you often feel that there is a move now to do the same with Iran. And I think that we have to be very clear that the persecution is intolerable, and we need to support people and defend people's rights, but as equal citizens in a free society and an equal society in Iran. And I think that I have a problem with Iranians being labeled as Muslims. I don't see why, out of the millions of characteristics that people have in their lives, that why one label has to take precedence and be more important than any others. And I have the same feeling with ethnicity as well. I think that we need to be careful. A lot of these are constructed labels, that they don't begin to then bring about this feeling, well then Iran needs to be separated into a million different things, and let's possibly look forward to another Yugoslavia or what's happening in Iraq there. And I think that's why the issue of rights has to be kept very separately from the whole issue of separating and segregating people in any society.
Looking at where things go forward from here, we know that the United States has designs on Iran in terms of military operations, whether it be an invasion or an aerial bombardment to knock out the nuclear installations and so on. I think all of us who are acquainted with the human rights struggle and the left-wing and democratic struggle in Iran would say that would be a total disaster, because it would just strengthen the hardliners. You know, Ahmadinejad would play the nationalist card, would use national defense and security as a pretext to crack down further on dissent. And is that your view as well? And how do you see the situation vis-a-vis the prospects for regime change from within?
I mean, I think first of all, any attack by the U.S. before anything else, it would mean a human calamity and the tragedy that would it bring about, especially if attacks on nuclear installations are involved. So I think from that perspective, I think people should be completely opposed to it. And of course, as you said, it will strengthen the governments and give it, emergency powers to do as it wants. And just as much in the same way that it used the Iran-Iraq war early on to help maintain and stabilize its power by mass repression at that time and carrying out mass executions during that emergency period as well, because of the Iran-Iraq war in the early 80s. I think it would definitely strengthen the regime. And, look at what the U.S. has done in Iraq. There's definitely, if it's not going to get any worse, it's definitely not going to get any better, basically. And the swamp that Iraq has become, and how many years and centuries that even the U.S. has taken Iraqi people backwards with its attack there, that's definitely something we don't want to see in Iran, and people need to be opposed to any sort of attack by the U.S. government. But the problem is that oftentimes, if you look at the situation in Iraq, you see that there's this very pathetic group of people who call themselves left, who then think that if they want to oppose the U.S. imperialism and U.S. attacks, they then need to support the resistance in Iraq, which are just as parasitical and reactionary Islamic groups in Iraq that are making the lives of the people there hell, just as much as the U.S. is. And then you'll see that they're actually defending the Islamic Republic of Iran and its right to have nuclear weapons, for example.
They don't believe that Britain should have nuclear weapons.
Right, but they're fine with the Islamic Republic, and you have like the CND actually inviting the ambassador of the Iranian government to come and speak at one of its demonstrations. So I think what's important is that we have to say, yes, we're 100% opposed to the U.S.'s any sort of intervention in Iran. And from the perspective of the people in Iran, the scenario that the U.S. has in mind is not very different from the scenario that the Islamic Republic of Iran has in mind for the people of Iran. They're both right-wing, they're both reactionary, and they're both inhuman and against people's wishes and desires. And I think what's important is to say we won't support either side. What we're going to do is support the people of Iran, their movement for free, equal society. And there's so many, we see so many examples of it, from women's demonstrations, bus workers, teachers, youth. Day in and day out, we're seeing protests that we need to support. Solidarity needs to be a lot stronger with the people of Iran and against both the Islamic Republic of Iran and the US government's and UK government's intentions there.
Yeah. I mean, I've been constantly shocked at the way in which much of the anti-war movement has pointedly refused to condemn the repression and persecution in Iran. And these are by people who call themselves left-wingers and humanitarians, who would never tolerate the stoning to death of women in this country, who never tolerate the sacking of a woman from a job, let alone executing her, but seem to think that if you criticize a regime which is a form of clerical fascism, that somehow you're undermining the struggle against imperialism. The logic is so bizarre and upside down.
Yeah. I mean, I think part of it is post-colonial guilt, and, you know, there's that involved. The other is the fact that it's seen to be racist to criticize, what seems to be an oppressed religion, Islam, or, representatives of that religion. Whereas, in fact, no, it's a powerful right-wing reactionary movement. It has it's in state power in many places, or it's vying for political power in many places. It rules countries and affects millions and millions of people. And so it's not an oppressed religion. It doesn't represent resistance. And in fact, the movement in Iran is a resistance to that political Islamic movement. And it's important to make these distinctions. I think one of the other things, too, is that we need to hear more left people criticizing Islam, political Islam, the Islamic Republic of Iran, so that it's not seen as an arena that only the right wing is making criticism from, a virulently inhuman, racist, and despicable reactionary position. We need the left to do that, and that's something that we've often done, so that actually people say, yes, there's a space. You can criticize religion, you can criticize people's beliefs, you can criticize political groups that are linked to it, states, but that has nothing to do with racism against people. And in fact, you need to do that if you actually want to defend people's rights and lives.
I think some people would say is, in fact, it's a benign, inverse form of racism.
Definitely.
Not to criticize regimes like Iran, because you're judging them by a different standard because they're non-white or because they're of a different faith.
Yeah,
and if you believe in universal human rights, then all people should be judged and treated equally, so that when they do bad things, they're condemned in the same way as you condemn a Christian or a white person, and when they do good things, they're praised.
But and also, why is the? I mean, I don't think a lot of people here think Tony Blair's policies represent them. Why is it, though, that when it comes to the so-called third world, the government represents everybody living there? So it's the government's religion, it's the government's culture, actually, that's imposed by force. It's often seen as the culture and religion of people living there, and that is racism, isn't it? Pure and simple. And I think it's important to make these distinctions and so that people feel comfortable. The vast majority of people are, despise both US's imperialism and intervention, and also political Islam and what Islamic terrorism is doing across the world. And I think that it's important for them to be able to say that, and at the same time show solidarity with the survivors and victims of both of them, without feeling like they have to take one side or the other.
I mean, what's your take on the prospects for regime change from within, by and for the people, as opposed to dictated by the United States?
I mean, I think the prospects are extremely good in the sense that if anybody who is an observer, a close observer of the situation in Iran, they can see that there's, you know, you even have the Economist saying another revolution, for example, after the 1999 student protest. So you do have even right-wing commentators in the media talking about this explosive situation in Iran.
Are we talking about the next 5 years, 10 years?
Well, but that's the thing. I mean, it's a struggle and a battle, isn't it? You have, if you have the U.S.'s intervention in Iran, it could set it back, you know, decades. If you have interventions in different forms, even more so. If you have more solidarity and support for the people of Iran and their struggle internationally, and a clear opposition to both the U.S. and the Islamic Republic of Iran, it could be sooner.
Isn't there a problem, though, that in Iran, the opposition is very fragmented? There's the women's struggle, the workers' struggle, the students' struggle, the gay rights struggle, the national minority struggle, but they're all separate and disparate. I know there's a beginning of a coalescing together, but it's very, very weak and very, very, you know, small scale at the moment.
And I wouldn't say that. I think that if you look at the events in Iran, you see actually a lot of, you know, cross these movements, crossing each other and supporting each other and working together. And I think that it's a very strong movement. I think it's a very left movement, actually, and it's a very progressive movement. And it's very clear. Its demands are very clear and becoming more and more clear as time goes on. And I think what's important is to support that struggle in whatever way people can, and to make sure that it comes to light. For example, the article you wrote, a lot of work that you do in highlighting what's happening in Iran. I think it's important for people to actually see what's going on and not just get the mainstream media's view, which basically seems to say, you know, Iran has a right to nuclear weapons, and that's basically it.
Or just no coverage of the human rights abuses.
Oh, that's out of the question. That's out of the question.
I'm constantly astonished at the poor or non-existent reporting of grotesque human rights abuses in Iran. You know, this week we've seen, you know, highlighting about the terrible abuses in Zimbabwe, quite rightly.
Yeah.
But there are things like that happening in Iran, and they just never get coverage.
I think it's not. Western governments would prefer to. Well, a lot of European governments have very close trade and business relations with the Islamic Republic of Iran. Britain does, so does Germany and many other countries.
Yeah, which former conservative minister is one of the key people behind this?
Well, I mean, I think in general, I think the government, from Labour to conservatives, are very keen to have relations, and they have relations with, we know, many different despicable governments. It's business as usual in many instances. And I think it helps to portray the people of Iran as actually being represented by an Islamic regime. And as long as this whole nuclear crisis that's come up is really not about nuclear weapons, we know that, because, as you said, Britain has and wants to expand its weapons and has relations with other countries, including in the so-called third world, that have weapons. So the issue is more about putting Iran in its place, particularly in relation with the situation in Iraq at this time and place. And so, in effect, you know, we know that it's got nothing to do with rights. They want to carry on business as usual. They'd like to do that. And they'd like to portray Iran, all Iranians, as Muslims, and the most reactionary of Islamists at that. And I think that's why you often don't see coverage, because it contradicts the general message that people actually have of Iran.
Okay, well, we'll have to leave it there. Thank you very much, Maryam Namazi.
Thank you.
Please join me next week for Talking with Tatchell. We'll be discussing another topical issue, and I look forward to seeing you then. Bye-bye.